Now this metal thingy here, it does look intriguing, I would say. But nothing happens when you press it or apply various DC voltages. But when you hook it up to just the right circuit, then it suddenly can become a push button. Or more generally speaking, it can convey information through all kinds of vibration patterns, because this is a haptic feedback system. I wanted to test such a system for quite a while, ever since I experienced haptic feedback for the first time through my PS5 controller. But the thing is, such tech is not really easy to find if you're looking for a plug-and-play solution. So I was super happy to see that Mouser Electronics had a suitable, ready-to-use development board in stock that could do just the thing. And in this video, I not only want to present you this haptic future tech, but also two other really awesome development boards whose main ICs and their functionality you might want to include in your next projects. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Mouser Electronics, who, like I mentioned before, not only offer the newest development boards and of course electronics components, but also specifically for my viewers created an awesome Arduino Uno reference guide that you can download for free. And while you're at it, you can also enter the giveaway to win an official Arduino Uno Rev4. I wish you good luck! Now let's start off with haptic feedback and the questions, what is it and why you might see it more often in the future. To answer that, we have to look at electronic devices that interact with a user, like my alarm system. As you can see, it tells me via beeps that I push a button and uses LEDs to indicate when something is wrong. So the system basically uses sound and light to tell me important information, which works just fine for many applications. But with haptic feedback, you get another option of inputs, vibration. And I know what you're thinking, even older electric devices use vibration as a way to communicate with the user, with, for example, such vibration motors. These are basically just DC motors, onto the shaft we got an unbalanced load, and thus it vibrates while in motion. But the problem with these is that they can only either be on or off, or turn a bit slower or faster depending on the applied voltage, which does not allow for precise information. With haptic feedback, however, you can literally play back audio waveforms to give the user exactly the information you want. For example, let's imagine we have a parking sensor for a car. Light information does not work, because you have to concentrate on everything around you. Sound does work, but that can get annoying eventually. Haptic feedback in the steering wheel would be perfect here, because depending on the frequency of the waveform, you can wonderfully tell the user how close you are to the wall. And that is just one example of many, proving that haptic feedback has the potential to significantly improve electronic devices. So next, to find out how they do it, I had a look inside my PS5 controller and found this rather big thingy here, which is a voice coil actuator. It more or less consists of a coil and a magnet, which is more or less how loudspeaker is built as well. Meaning that as soon as we apply an AC voltage to the actuator, it vibrates with that set frequency. But sadly, I could not find this specific actuator on the internet for sale. However, I found these piezo-haptic actuators, which produce a voltage spike when they are deformed, and of course also deform on their own and vibrate when a high enough voltage gets applied, meaning they can act as an input and output device. Only problem is that we need a bit of a higher voltage to drive them. And that is where the development board from Boreas comes into play, because its driver boards with the BOS1921 IC can create a 190 volt peak-to-peak voltage. Besides that, it can also sense rather low voltages, which is important when using the actuator as an input. It allows streaming of digital waveforms for playback, and even features a waveform synthesizer, which makes it super simple to quickly playback specific waveforms. Pretty awesome stuff, and in combination with the included microcontroller boards and the given software, it was easy to make your own waveforms, playback a whole bunch of different example waveforms, and utilize the push button feature so that the actuator vibrates in a specific way as soon as you press it. And as a bonus, you also get audio mode, in which the actuator acts like a speaker for your computer, which did work just fine, but also simply sounded wrong. So all in all, I love the software. The datasheet for the dev board gives you all information you need to create your own boards around this IC, and the datasheet of the IC is easy to understand when it comes to communicating with it through the I2C communication protocol. This one, by the way, you can easily try out because the driver board has all important pins available. So yeah, super happy with this haptic feedback system, and I hope to implement it in a project very soon. Moving on though to this Energy Harvester development board, built around the AEM00900. Now the idea of the board is that it harvests energy from one photovoltaic cell, and uses that to charge up a storage device, like a battery or capacitor. This storage device will most likely power a low power sensor, that only completely turns on occasionally to gather data, and then send that over to a home station. So you basically create a system that you do not have to charge up or change batteries, which is obviously an awesome idea for low power devices. But wait a minute, you might say, such small solar cells do create enough voltage to, for example, charge up two supercapacitors in series on their own with a studio light acting as an artificial sun. So why bother with this dev board? Well, the minimum solar input voltage of the board ranges from 0.12 volts to 1.47 volts. Meaning it is made to utilize a very low voltage, and thus only one tiny photovoltaic cell. In my case though, I only had this big one for testing here, and trust me, I searched for alternatives, but they all came with a voltage that was too high. But getting back to topic, because this board not only works with low voltages, but it apparently also comes with a great efficiency when it comes to charging the storage device, which is always important when collecting very little energy. So I set the jumpers of the dev board in a way that the minimum solar voltage is 0.46 volts and the storage voltage is 3.01 volts to 4.12 volts. Then I hooked up my supercapacitors and the PV cell to find out whether the board really does its job, and it seems to charge the supercaps just fine. So next I measured the output and input power, and varied the artificial sunlight in order to calculate some efficiencies, which all looked pretty good. So all in all, very happy with the board, and since the datasheet comes with all information you need, and controlling the IC is easy to do with the I2C interface, you quickly see that once again everything was done right here, and maybe one day this IC comes in handy for me. Moving on to the last dev board, which probably looks the most spectacular of all three. It is based around the AS7058, which is this tiny IC here. What it basically can do is drive LEDs and use photodiodes and electrodes as inputs to provide multi-vital signal monitoring, consisting of PPG, ECG, BIOZ and EDA. And I know that this sounds super complicated, but in a nutshell, all these measurements simply monitor your most important vital signals. This can be very important when you have health problems, or, like me, want to track with your smartwatch how your heart rate is holding up while doing workouts. My smartwatch, though, can only do my heart rate in beats per minute, which is pretty standard by using an LED and a photodiode. But with this thing, you can obviously do way more, which I of course tested out immediately with the given software. And I gotta say that this is probably the best development board software I ever tested, because you got presets for all kinds of different functions. They explain in detail what register does exactly what, and when to set what in which function modes. And you got an awesome output graph for the results. What more could you ask for? And measuring my heart rate and respiration rate, as well as my oxygen saturation, was apparently no problem at all. But I was not able to measure my body impedance as well as my skin resistance, because for that you need external electrodes, that I do not have. But the ECG function, which I think is the closest to future tech and pretty important, seems to work just fine. Only problem was that this time there was no output for non-medical idiots like me. So I was not entirely sure what I was looking at here. And if you have a clue, then feel free to write a comment underneath this video. But anyway, all in all, I think when it comes to dev boards, this one is probably the best when it comes to testing the functionality of an IC. And the datasheets are also fantastic. But I kind of doubt that I will ever design a smartwatch or similar. But at least I know now where I would have to start. With that being said, I hope you enjoyed the future tech I explored today. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.